There's Wayne.
With all the evidence pointing us to the same area, Master Prospector Wayne Tuttle has agreed to guide us to that location and determine if there is in fact gold there.
Good to see you, Wayne.
How's it doing?
This part of the desert is rarely explored, and with no roads, the journey won't be easy.
So here's where the GPS coordinates point at the mine.
Could be.
We're over here, Mesquite Flat, so...
Yeah, and you see all the trails here. There is nothing there, so we're going to be bushwhacking it from point A to point B there.
Okay.
We're pretty much burning daylight, so we probably should get started.
What do we got here?
We got some pans.
Old school.
There ain't no any other thing but old school. Unless one of you guys want to carry a sluice.
I'll take this. All right, let's head out.
So I would say in this area here, what we want to do is do a little placering, check and see if we're going to find any gold in the wash.
So that's like panning for gold?
Panning for gold, yeah.
And if we placer and we find some remnants of gold, it could mean that we're close to a vein or potentially close to the mine.
It means gold's come into this area from somewhere.
Okay.
And if we find nothing, that tells us we're in an area that's barren of gold. So let's get a sample back up under here.
And why would you be digging under the tree as opposed to anywhere else in this bed?
Well, back up in here is where the gold would lodge. The water comes down out of the mountains periodically when we have heavy rains. Then what we'll do here, we'll get the other bigger stuff out of here. So we'll get that out of here. And then we'll come down here to the water.
Because gold is denser than dirt, when you sift it through water, the sand and debris is washed away, leaving, hopefully, gold flakes that stick to the bottom of your pan.
The gold's heavier than anything that's in there. So if there's any gold in here, it's gonna stay at the bottom.
If we can find any, that means we're on the right track. And a larger source of gold is likely nearby.
It's not giving us anything here. We're not seeing anything gold-wise in there. So we'll just hit another spot. Okay, there you guys go. You see it?
All right, let me get close.
See the spots here?
Oh, yeah.
You see it?
Oh. Is that straight up gold?
This is gold.
And this was just like flakes of gold were in the
sand?
This
is the small stuff that's broken off and moving through.
Dead center in the pan, you can clearly see the gold. Obviously the flake is small, but we do know it's gold. Having found this gold here means that it's coming from somewhere.
Yeah, and the fact that we picked it up out of there means it's probably working out of somewhere up here, up in this area above us.
There's an opening on that mountainside. And it's located right in the heart of our search zone.
Cutting this little wash, I mean, that's gonna take us right up there.
It's not an easy hike, but we've gotta see what it is.
I mean, look at all this. What you got there? That's the iron oxide.
Yeah, I mean, look at all that.
Red dirt means that there's a high concentration of iron oxide. We know that iron oxide pops up in regions that are thick with gold deposits. Clearly, there's something in this mine. Do you see anything?
Whoa.
You gotta see this, buddy.
Yeah, buddy. Oh, that's wild.
Oh, you wanna get my flashlight, the smallest one in the front?
Here it is.
Going in?
Let's go. I'll follow you with the camera. It's really damp and it's clearly man-made. And it's made out of this iron oxide rock, which means that if it's not there now, gold would have been here at some point. We're about 20 feet or so into the rock. It's a 2x6 entrance, perfectly carved, but it's not exactly stable. So we're gonna search and see if we can find some traces of gold.
A lot of effort went into getting up here and extracting something.
I mean, look at this.
We're dealing with some quartzite,
iron oxide,
really interesting stuff. It is said that the Dutchman mine contains the largest cache of gold ever found on American soil. But as Emiliano and I get deeper into it, if it's as rich as history says it is, we think it's too small to really be the Dutchman gold mine. they went as far back as they could and they didn't find anything, so they turned back. But it means that this rock is a clue. It's a further clue getting us closer to figuring out where this gold might be.
Between the Landsat 8 satellite map, the Peralta prospecting map, and physical signs of gold, everything is telling us that the Lost Dutchman's mine is somewhere in this 3-square-mile area.
Look at that.
A little better view of the area here.
You know what's weird is if you look at just that peak, you compare it to the other peaks, all the other peaks have those kind of watermarks.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And this one, it's a slant. It's like the whole mountain almost shifted.
Mm.
Some major event happened to that peak itself.
Yeah. Take a look at that right there.
Yeah, it seems kind of misplaced, doesn't it?
Look where it came from. See where it fits in? The whole quarter of that entire ridge fell down.
It's clearly a wall, yeah. And that's like the missing jigsaw piece.
Yeah.
What do you think, seismic activity?
Well, if that's the case, it would explain why no one can find it.
Did something happen in this area, possibly an earthquake, burying the mine under hundreds of feet of rubble? Is that the reason no one's been able to find it for nearly 2 centuries? To find out, we're heading to Arizona State University.
Professor Aerosmith?
Hi.
Justin
nice
for now.
To meet with Dr. Ramon Aerosmith, a structural geologist who's been studying the rock formations and fault lines in this area for over 20 years.
Are earthquakes common in this area?
Not so common. We might have big ones every 10,000 years or so, but there's a famous one that was in 1887, the biggest earthquake in Arizona, the Pitaycachi earthquake, and it was felt right in the superstitions.
Just how powerful was this earthquake?
What this map shows is the intensity measures from the earthquake. So it was felt all the way to Mexico City,
wow.
Albuquerque, so it was widely felt.
So we're actually, I can point it out, we're actually here. You see what looks kind of like the head of a bat?
Yeah.
So we think at this peak is maybe where our mine could be.
Yeah, you know, I think that there's a lot of steep slopes in that region, and so if you have a ground shaking from a big earthquake, those cliff faces could fall down and maybe burying that mine. And there's also this report from this newspaper from back then. This one rancher, he talked about how the earth commenced rocking, and he enjoyed a very interesting view of some of the toppling cliffs of that range just near the Salt River, so it's in this area.
Two of the tallest buttes, which guard the entrance to a canyon, toppled over and met each other in midair.
So those are enormous.
Yeah, there's a picture from that earthquake, and you can see what happened. In the earthquake, the ground broke. The cowboys are there, you know, they're probably 6 feet tall, so you can see it's almost 3 times their height.
This ground was pushed out about, 18 feet by the earthquake.
Yeah.
So it's reasonable to say that this earthquake could have affected the Dutchman's mine.
Yeah.
That could explain everything.
It's under rubble or just collapsed completely.
That actually is a pretty plausible explanation.
This is all lining up. The Dutchman's gold mine was reported to be in operation until the late 1800s, and Jacob Waltz was the last person to see it with his own eyes in the 1880s. Then, in 1887, there's a massive earthquake, and no one has seen the mine since. Could the reason that no one has found it since Waltz be because there's no way to get to it?
One other thing I want to show you, in 1891, there was a record-breaking flood, so that would also help change the topography that it may now never be rediscovered.
That's the year that our mine owner died.
The legend of the Lost Dutchman's mine speaks of Jacob Waltz contracting pneumonia after a flood in 1891. Leading to his infamous deathbed map. According to archival evidence, there was in fact a massive flood in this area the exact year that the legend spoke of the same thing.
That could have been the death knell. That floodwaters could have just finished the mine off completely.
So the mine could be buried underwater, buried under rock. People have been searching for something that's disappeared a long time ago.